quiero presentar en esta entrevista a mi amigo Aaron Bauer. Aaron Matthew Bauer nació en Nueva York, estudió zoología en la Universidad Estatal de Michigan y se doctoró en la Universidad de California, Berkeley. Actualmente está en la Universidad de Villanova, donde es profesor de biología y ocupa una cátedra de biología integrativa. Es autor de más de 600 artículos en revistas, capítulos de libros, principalmente sobre sistemática, morfología evolutiva, paleontología, ecología y biogeografía de reptiles, particularmente de lagartos, y ha descrito aproximadamente 150 nuevas especies de reptiles. Es el herpetólogo más prolífico en la descripción de especies que esté vivo actualmente. Mantiene un programa activo de investigación de campo en Namibia, Sudáfrica, Angola, Australia, Nueva Caledonia, India, Malasia y otras partes del mundo. También se interesa y publica sobre historia y bibliografía de la herpetología y la museología. Actualmente se desempeña como editor o miembro del comité editorial de más de 12 revistas nacionales e internacionales. Vive en Pensilvania con su esposa Mónica y ambos me recibieron en su casa y Aaron me recibió en su laboratorio. Es un muy buen amigo.
Hi Aaron, thank you for participating in this course of Reptilia.
So really, you know, you have the vast majority of geckos would be characterized as having four limbs, usually having five toes per limb, very little reduction, large head, relatively short tail for a lizard, relatively large eyes. So this sort of morphotype of a sort of typical limbed gecko, but with a sort of very obvious sort of pedomorphic characters in the sense that the proportions of the body nearly always have a proportionally larger head and shorter tail than in most other lizard groups. So that would account for really more than 95% of all geckos. But the very different morphotype would be the limbless or reduced-limbed morphotype that you see in the one of the families of geckotans in the pygopods, where you have the so-called flap-footed lizards with really very small, flap-like appendages only in the hind legs, never with independent fingers, always fused together. In these animals, you have very long tails, very small heads, still very large eyes in comparison to most reduced-limbed lizards. So even though the heads are not so big, the eyes are quite large. And unlike most geckos with limbs, which tend to have granular scales, you have a tendency towards more overlapping scales, more skink-like scales in most, but not all, pygopods. So there are a number of gecko genera that are, we could say, very typical in body form. So the genus Gecko is one in tropical Asia, but I might pick actually Hemidactylus as one of the more typical kinds, more than 100 species, very widespread. Toe pads are present, although sometimes they can be quite reduced. So this is a group that really fits that description of relatively large head, relatively short tail, mostly granular scales, some tubercles. So those would be very typical geckos. They're also nocturnal. So although the majority of geckos are nocturnal, you do have quite a few, several hundred species, more than 400 species certainly, that are in fact diurnal. So diurnality would be kind of one of the variations on the theme that we see. So for geckos, it's a secondary characteristic, since geckos ancestrally are nocturnal, and we can see that by looking at gecko skulls. If you go back and look at gecko skulls back as far as the Cretaceous, they lack the parietal opening, so we know that that's typical for nocturnal forms. So it seems that at least for the last 150 million years, geckos were a nocturnal group with multiple independent derivations of diurnality, sometimes accompanied by many changes in the eye, sometimes with almost no changes in the eye. And in some groups, like Nemaspis, group of geckos in Asia, as well as Spherodactylus in the New World, we see examples where we think the transitions are still taking place, where we have new taxa that are evolving changes in their period of activity. So that is a big variant in coral geckos, is this period of activity. We also have some aberrant body forms. You have leaf-tailed geckos, which occur in several different groups, different families of geckotans, which primarily are associated with crypsis and disrupting the body form for these, in this case, mostly slow-moving, trunk-dwelling animals. We also have, of course, other skin flaps. So in things like Typozoan, we have parachuting geckos that regularly jump from trees and expand out their webs between the toes and the flaps along the sides of the body to glide or to parachute down.
Those are Southeast Asia.
Mostly in Southeast Asia, although it turns out that many geckos that don't have quite the same level of specialization are capable of doing this too. So Thecodactylus, which is a New World gecko, really from the Virgin Islands down through Brazil, uh-huh. Thecodactylus rapicauda is able to glide or to parachute as well. So the specializations don't have to be extreme morphologically if the animal combines slightly larger surface area with the right behavioral characteristics, they're able to do this. Scalation variation is another one. I mentioned that the average gecko sort of has small granular scales, but we have Geckolepis in Madagascar, which has large fish-like scales, which pull away from the animal. If you try to grab the animal or a predator tries to grab the animal, the scales just come off in the hand. And this
is a way to escape.
It's a wonderful escape mechanism. If I can mention, one of my first field trips was to the Seychelles in the Indian Ocean, and there was a species there that did this. And even though I knew it did that, the first time I grabbed one and its skin came off, I was shocked, and the animal escaped. So this, you think, for a totally naive predator, this really is going to be a successful mechanism. At least the first few times, it's really going to surprise you, and the animal really does have an increased likelihood of survival because of this.
It's scary because the gecko became nude.
Yes, it's
scary.
Yes, you have this little pink naked gecko, which is really disconcerting. It's really a shock to see this. But we also have other geckos. We can mention vocalization, although geckos in general are the best vocalizers of all reptiles. We do have some geckos that really make extreme vocalization. So one good example would be the bell geckos, the genus Tenopus in southern Africa. When they were discovered by Sir Andrew Smith in the 1830s, he wrote that they had to move their camp that night because they couldn't sleep from the tremendous noise made by these. And so for people who are familiar with the chorusing of frogs, these geckos are geckos where hundreds of individual males will call from their burrow entrances at the same time. And you have the same effect. It's like being at a noisy pond at night, only you're in the desert, and it's these geckos that are vocalizing. It's, you know, the majority of geckos vocalize at least distress calls. So if you pick them up and disturb them, most geckos will make at least a little squeak, although many diurnal geckos don't really seem to be capable of using other types of vocal communication. So you have this division, the diurnal geckos relying often on on visual cues, so things like Felsuma, the bright green geckos of Madagascar and the Indian Ocean, that are signaling to each other using their colors, whereas the nocturnal geckos are really relying much more heavily on these vocalizations.
Which is the largest and smallest geckos of all?
So, of what we believe to be the living species of geckos, for the limbed geckos, there's Rhacodactylus lycianus, which gets to be more than 250 millimeters in snout bent length. Mm-hmm. The biggest one that I ever saw was about 700 grams. So that's, for a gecko, that's pretty big. Although for the limbless geckos, Lialis burtonis can get to more than 700 millimeters in length, and of course thin-bodied, but still quite a large animal. And then on the opposite end, you have several species of Spherodactylus, where adult maximum sizes are less than 18 millimeters snout vent length.
Okay, Aaron, thank you very much to participate of this course.
Well, happy to do it.